Seth Rollins and Eric Rowan was a miss for me. They had a false count anywhere match that ended with Rollins pinning Rowan under a forklift, the halftime heat finish from 1999, reincarnated 20 years later. They managed to take the one thing I did not like about that halftime heat match, the finish, and they used it here. I liked everything else about that match. I love Vince McMahon on commentary. I love the whole empty arena setting and Mankind getting his ass kicked and The Rock with all of his insults and then brawling into the catering or the cafeteria, wherever they were, and throwing pies and cakes and shit at each other. You know, in the office, the phone rings, Rock picks up the phone. I loved everything about that match except the finish. I always thought that that was a goofy finish with the forklift thing, even though they had a great camera shot. There was a camera, which is also ridiculous when you think about it. But there was a camera attached to the forklift. And they managed to take that one element of that match I didn't like, and they used it here. So I was not a fan of this. But speaking of Seth Rollins, the now former Universal Champion, he was a guest on the first episode of Corey Graves' new WWE podcast, After the Bell. By the way, Corey Graves has said that this is going to be an unfiltered show. You know, he constantly goes on about, I might get fired, I might get in trouble for saying this. So I, for one, and I hope you guys will join me, I, for one, cannot wait to hear his unfiltered point of view about this whole Saudi Arabia debacle. I'm waiting with bated breath. I'm sure episode 2 will have the full unfiltered story. I can't wait. But I only listened to the Rollins portion of this first podcast that he did. Graves brought up the finish to the Hell in a Cell match with Rollins and the Fiend and the fan reaction to it. And not two sentences into his answer, Rollins was calling all of those people who didn't like that finish and crapped all over that finish whiners and complainers. So here's Seth Rollins on this podcast whining about the whiners. He said, it's sort of like if people don't get what they want, they whine about it on Twitter. That's kind of what happens nowadays, and that happens with everything. It's not just our industry. By the way, that's right. Case in point, Seth Rollins, who every Sunday apparently goes on Twitter and says, I hate football. So he should know. But he says, if you do something and it strikes a chord, then it's almost like you're doing the right thing. I don't even know anymore. It's a weird industry. It's 2019, and I don't know what wrestling looks like anymore. It is a weird place. He says, you could go back 6 months. You can go back a year ago, Hell in a Cell. I was everybody's favorite. Those same people who were panning Hell in a Cell and talking about how Seth Rollins is not cool are the same people who were clamoring for me to be the guy to face Brock Lesnar going into WrestleMania. So I don't know what changed except for the fact that I became the person they wanted me to be, and then they hated me for it. And so it's a very fickle audience, but to answer your question directly, it feels awful. It's not a good feeling to go out there and put your body on the line, and not just at Hell in a Cell, but every single night for the past however many years I've been doing it, I've gone out and competed at an extremely high level, and dare I say I'm one of the very best at my job. And I do what I have to do when I have to do it, and so it hurts your feelings. You're a human being and you work hard. It's a tough pill to swallow sometimes. Seth Rollins is not totally wrong about the fans being fickle, but I don't know that I have ever seen another top guy in his position in WWE as the champion in WWE whining so much about being treated unfairly, calling the fans whiners because they hated a shit finish that was universally panned, shitting on the fans for not accepting mediocrity at a time when he happens to be the champion. Yeah, I'll bet it's a tough pill for him to swallow. I'll bet. Shitting on the fans is hardly going to make his problems go away, as thin-skinned as he is about this stuff. You know, what wasn't a good look for him were some of the comments he made about Jon Moxley after Moxley spilled his guts about why he left the company. Then the back and forth on Twitter with Will Ospreay and the line about the bank account comparing, you know, I got a bigger bank account than you do, which he at least had the humility to apologize for because he realized he fucked up. The stuff with Omega, I don't count because that was a receipt for what Omega said. And I look at all that, the stuff with Omega is being in jest. None of that stuff is to be taken seriously. So I don't hold that against him. I actually defended Rollins a week or two ago on that. So I'm not even counting that. But it just was one thing after another with these comments to Sports Illustrated, the tweets on social media. It came one right after the other. It painted him in a poor light as this whiny little brat. An athletic one, you know, CrossFit Jesus. Very good wrestler, but a whiny little brat. But what I heard here didn't do much to change my opinion about the way that he's been acting. With so much wine, I'm surprised he doesn't own his own vineyard in Napa Valley.